Okay. Rules and not rules and knowing about rules. And knowing the rules we observe. There are some empirical studies I read recently which are somewhat interesting when it comes to economics. And I try, by working here it's not so difficult anyway, but I want to try to kind of work against it. These have been empirical studies made in the United States, Big Brother country, at different universities looking at economists and one university was MTI and the other was, I don't know actually, Cambridge or something, doesn't matter, Chicago, it's it. So, what was interesting, that these universities, students from these universities, answered on certain value-based questions in a very specific way. Fundamental questions, priority given to inflation, limiting inflation versus stability of employment. Things like this. Very general, very basic questions. It was hugely significant in statistical terms where people studied. The answer of MTI students had been different from the answer given by Chicago. Now it's well known that there are certain schools in economics and they are usually linked to certain universities. Again, just to make you aware of what happens, there is this process of selection. It's a kind of natural thing, kind of. If you at some stage come to me asking me, I want to write my PhD, would you be my supervisor? And then there's a good boy, always agreeing with what I say. Then there's a bad girl, always opposing and asking questions and making my life difficult. Then I say, good boy, of course you can. Well, actually, wouldn't you consider to go to some other supervisor, bad girl, I won't say bad girl, but it may be that you have a better supervision there. And I will bring you to this person, where I see there is agreement, there is basically agreement, and there will be no conflict. It's a kind of natural thing, but at the same time it should be something we should work against it. We should try to find disagreement that we actually can convince the other person, the bad girl or the bad boy, actually are wrong. I knew it before, but I can show you are wrong. Or I can allow you to show me that I'm wrong and that I have to revise whatever I did before. But I say it's not employment, but it is inequality. It's a huge personal challenge as well, challenging your own values. I mentioned in another context during another lecture, this habituality. And I remember I'd been once on a meeting in Brussels. And after the meeting, four Swedish people asked me if I would join them for a drink. They would like to talk about a little bit about future cooperation with me, and they would just have like to have a little bit of fun. Then we went to a pub. There was music in the background, and we had been chatting about this and that. Now, I don't know if you know Swedish people. I don't know if you know people from Macedonia. So the people off are always behaving in a certain way. Prejudices, but there is something that may be true. As I said, it was not a business meeting, really. It was a kind of small talk chat. There was music in the background, and this girl from Macedonia was swimming to the music, and ta-da. And then there was this Swedish bureaucrat standing there. And he said, listen, there's something I'm really sorry about. I feel really bad about it. But this is how we Swedes are. The Macedonian was, she lived in Sweden. She had Swedish nationality, citizenship, and so on. But she was originally from Macedonia, southern country. So this is what you have to get used to if you are working with Swedish people. Look at me. Gray suit, gray shirt, black shoes, gray tie, and here I am standing. I listen to the music. I would like to dance a little bit, to swing with it or whatsoever, but I cannot. We don't do this. We Swedish bureaucrats don't do it. Now, I know many Swedish bureaucrats, they do it. But there is something, and I'm not talking about Swedes and Macedonia and whatsoever, about nationality, but there is something we have habitualized, and we behave in a certain way, as well in academia, and it is difficult for us to cross the border, to say, I don't have to do it this way. There are other ways of doing things. Kitchen Stories is a film. And you may enjoy a little.
In 1944, Swedish scientists studied the habits of housewives to design a specially perfect working environment. In 1950, they took their experiment on the road, entering the homes and kitchens of single Norwegian men. The scientific rules for survival: build trust with your subject. Collect data unobtrusively.
Hello.
Observe without interference. And for the sanctity of the study, never become friends. IFC Films proudly presents a comedy the LA Times calls Irresistible, a completely charming film.
It was a very simple thing. Scientific experiment. Saying basically, go there, you observe how people behave. You don't interact with people, you just observe. You are in the same room, you are in the kitchen, you observe how these old or how these men behave in the kitchen. Don't interact. Building trust means I guarantee anonymity. I only observe What I can observe, there is no danger for you that there is a negative effect from this. Collect data unobtrusively means you allow people to act as they want, and you don't go there and look at the notes, and you don't turn it around, and you don't say, sorry, can I just turn it around? You just observe without interference. It's as well, you just take a photograph. You may take a film. You record something. But this is it. This means you don't really engage with the other person or with people. You pretend you are not there. These are all hugely, hugely valuable rules. This is how you should behave. Just look at what is going on. If the apple falls, don't say, stop, could you please go back? I have to make some notes. You won't stop this apple here and see what happens then. Next stage. Leave it the flow to the experiment. Tip people. Now with the apple it's fine. It falls. With people it's sometimes fine because they don't know that you are there. It may be a little bit unfair because you observe people without their knowledge, without their consent. This is something actually you should not do. There are certain ethical standards, and these standards, part of these standards is I tell you what I'm doing. If you agree, you agree. If you don't agree, I don't do it. These are very tricky questions. In any case, these are valid, good rules. The problem is, in most of the cases, I know that you are observing me. And I will behave in a different way. In whichever situation this is the case. If somebody looks at the mobile phone, I just ignore it. If somebody looks at me and just looks at me, I say, okay, fine. Seems to be listening. If somebody looks at me and looks like a question mark, I may come back to it and try to explain it a little bit further. If somebody observes me in the kitchen, where I may usually have the socks on the table next to the soup bowl and I don't know what, if somebody observes me, I will do something else. I will tidy up and behave as I would expect the other person expects me to behave. So there are different ways of observation. Something you have to learn, and you have to learn when, under which conditions, to which purpose. Is it appropriate to use one or the other way of observation? There is this neutrality. The other extreme is actually participatory observation. Unemployment. I go to the labor office, instead of looking at the statistics, and I engage with these people. And actually, I don't just go there and communicate with them, but engage with somebody and say, well, you have this problem, you have this problem. Can we do something together, or can we will find a solution for you, and we will find a solution for you. Let's observe the situation, and let's try to do something, make something out of it. And let's try, I did this once, I'm very proud of this. I was actually called to the labor office. I have had to show up there, trying to get a job or some benefits or whatever. And they told me at 9 o'clock you have to be there in the morning. I didn't mind 9 o'clock, I'm up anyway. But then it was 10 o'clock and there was no movement. There had been 10 people sitting, nothing happened. Occasionally the door was opened. And I saw people walking behind, having coffee, chatting, whatsoever. I was getting 11 and still nothing happened, and I have had my appointment at 9 o'clock. I didn't have anything to do. I have had something to read with me. I was fine. But I thought it's pretty annoying, this way of treating. The door opened from inside. I opened the door and I said, listen, I have an appointment at 9 o'clock. These people are waiting since 9 o'clock. I don't know for one. They have an appointment, but not here for being waiting for 2 hours. It took 1 minute I was in the office. This is part of participatory observation, because the other people had been called into the offices immediately after. You engage with the situation. You don't look at it simply and say, okay, you have to wait 2 hours. You engage with the situation. You make active use out of it. It's always the question, there's always a danger, how far you can do it. And there's always a problem when you should do it. It's not always appropriate. Is something about learning.
Falling and red at the bow, coma dance.
So the first thing is the question, not saying anything, what do you say? And how do you say it? There are different ways of communication. I worked for one of these institutes making questionnaires, going to people. It makes huge differences. That's a standardized way of doing mass interviews. You get a training up front. This is the questionnaire. It's amazing how you can waste your time. And you go to a building, you start to count the doors, and you go to every sixth door, but not just to every sixth door, but you start on the right side, go to the left, go to the next floor, you start on the left, go to the right, go to the next floor, start on the right, go to the left. I don't know, I think it was still one floor up to go to the sixth door. So it's very strict, the regulation, in order to have a certain pattern that is reliable, that you have the same conditions. This questionnaire, this survey, is done in a large city or in 20 medium-sized cities. You cannot allow one interviewer to do another thing than the other interviewer. Same conditions. And then you read. They tell you even the voice with which you should read. Friendly, gently. How often can you interrupt? When should you interrupt? You read the sentence. I am coming. I am working on behalf of. And then you do these questions. Strictly defined, every word is said in stone, set in stone. The way you say it is by instruction. It's not about chatting with somebody, because you want to have the same conditions for everybody, to get the same information from everybody. You control variables, as we say. If you do the questionnaire and you do the questionnaire, I don't know how you react. I tell you, smile. If you enter, wait until that you ask to enter and don't say, here I am. And don't say, here I am. Say it in a gentle way, or say it actually. This may be the instruction. Say it, I'm coming from here, I have to ask this question, answer. These are different questions, different surveys. And if you go through these interviews, these surveys, you will have many non-verbal communications. I give you five little pieces of paper with different colors or different forms. Which one would you associate with this and that question? Or the same. So this is different forms of communication, of saying something, and dealing with different ways of what is said and what is not said, and trying to find the meaning. In the second clip, these people communicate. They don't say a single word. There is so much communication happening. There is so much communication happening when we talk about economics. Even if we take terms, words, in many cases we can see already what it is about. Unemployment refers to employment and means not in employment, but it means unemployed. You are not unemployed. You are students. There's a certain definition of unemployment, and the definition of unemployment refers to employment. Meaning, it's not about work you do, you study, you do work, but this is not about employment. I hope you do work. All the homework, all the tests, all these beautiful things. This is not work in the understanding of employment, but unemployment is being available for the labor market, looking for a job, being available for the labor market, and you are not. And unemployed is if you are looking for a job and you are able to work, all conditions are fulfilled. So there's more to this definition, but you always have to look for the entire range of communication that takes place. As I said, it can take different forms. It is as well about context, again. And then there is this thing of trust we talked about. And trust is this formal thing of, I tell you that you can trust me. I give you even, and this was when I was working for this institute, something, you showed a declaration. And you signed the declaration and gave it to them. This is the guarantee that you can trust me. It's a legal document. If you see the data, something that you told me and only you during the survey, if you see this, so and so said, you can bring me to court. This is the one thing, and you can trust it. And most likely, you really can trust it, because I won't take the risk. The other thing is, what kind of information do you want to have? Let's talk about income. The question of income is usually stated, or is often stated, in just one single question: what is your monthly income? Then you may have to fill it in, or there is a range from 0 to 1,000, from 1,000 to 3,000, from 3,000 to 10,000, different ranges. And then you make you tick the correct box. Zero. Above 500,000. Whichever is correct. It's correct. The question is your monthly income. The question is not, is this the permanent monthly income? So if I assume It's better to answer, I have a low income, and this month I have a low income. I say, yeah, I have a low income. I won't disclose that my real income, the statistical income over the year, is actually somewhere here. I look for the answer that is best for me, where I think it is best. This is the impression I want to give you. And this is, of course, something you have to consider when elaborating a questionnaire. And it is something that you have to consider when working with answer, with questions, with interviews, with surveys. What kind of information do you want to have? And how do you receive this information? Is it really just by tick box? Or is there more going on? You may think that there is not much about economics in this. Just wanted to show you something, but I can't. I don't have money on me. You all know these little pieces of paper called paper money. Or the coins. This is trust . There are different forms of trust in this one is called fiat. We'll talk later about it. It's the guarantee by the government that 100 yuan are 100 yuan, and not 200 and not 50. If you have this piece of paper, and then you know what it is, it's 100. One point of trust. The other is I hope that if I give you 100 yuan, you have 50 twice, and you won't have one note, and I say we can change, I give you the 100, you give me the 250. You trust, I hope, that my money is real money and not coming from the photocopy shop around the corner. Trust is something that is hugely important and in different ways important in economy. It's about the meaning. We know what the meaning of something is. And we can be disappointed because we trust. We go to a shop, we buy something, after a week it's broken. We go there again, they say, well, that's not our problem. And you buy another one because they say it's not under warranty, but you need this thing, you go there, you buy it again. After a week you go back, sorry, it's broken again. After a while you won't trust them anymore, you will go to another shop and you may be more lucky. You may not be more lucky. There's something where we have to make a point, where we have to say, okay, this is all we can do at this stage. This is all what we need at this stage. Because we want to move on. We can't check everything. We have a proper reference, and we say, okay, we should move on now. We should investigate as well this and that. We may do it at a later stage, but for now we say stop, full stop. That's it. It's for any communication. And sometimes you feel sad about it. You meet a friend, you are chatting, you're enjoying yourself, and then the friend has to go to a lecture. But you want to talk about this and that. And you say, sorry, full stop, save it here, we can continue after the lecture, we can continue next month, next week, whenever, but now we have to stop. Working, income. At some stage you have to stop. You may have to think about different solutions, other solutions. I will put on blackboard a text, it's a novel, which shows the ambiguity as well, the contradictions with which we work in economics. The good person of Sichuan won't tell this the entire story, but it is about a good woman getting some money and opening a shop. She was very poor, and in this shop she distributes now to poor people. It's a tobacco shop, and she gives tobacco to the poor people. They ask her, can you give us, here it is. And she forgets to make the point. And she ruins this shop and cannot continue this shop because she gives everything to the poor people instead of earning money. And then she invents a cousin. The cousin, people still come to the shop and they see the cousin but not her. And they say, well, we want the tobacco, can you give it? Yeah, you can have the tobacco, work for it. And she is very strict, the requirements are very strict. And here's the other extreme, if you want. So he makes actually the point before he starts to talk. But this is something we are dealing with in economics, trying to figure out the standards, trying to move within a certain range of problems and trying to find a different solution. I don't know how true this is, this little fellow here. I said we have different ways of communication. We have written stuff, we write documents, we communicate, we use the telephone, we use WeChat. As I said, I didn't make an empirical study on this, but I feel tempted to do this at some stage. You use all these emoticons. I'm not good in this. I just use something that I think it looks nice, I just put it there. I probably say many wrong things, which I actually don't mean. But anyway, you sometimes use these things, these emoticons, in the middle of the sentence. My impression is the best way of stopping, of ending a communication, is use one emoticon. Just send, after somebody tells you this and that, just send an emoticon. Don't say anything, don't write anything. Don't write, send an emoticon, and continue. Just an emoticon. It would be interesting to see how many communications with WeChat are ended this way. My impression is the easiest way of ending a communication is just send one of these fellows and that's it. It doesn't work always. It is not empirically proven, but I think there's a good reason to investigate something like this. And there are actually many studies, I didn't know how many studies there are on using emoticons, using different symbols in communication. At some stage throughout the year, this will come back in different forms. We will narrow things down, looking at the drawers, looking at the boxes, looking at the definitions. That's something you have to learn. But there's something more important that you have to learn. All the knowledge is not value-free, and all this knowledge stands in a wider context. And this wider context is the highest education is that which does not merely give us information, but makes our life in harmony with all existence. Meaning, whatever you do in economics, think about it, what is the effect on environmental issues? Whatever is there, what is the effect on workers, on people in general, on customers? This is what we will approach. The stuff will be on the internet again. I will have there as well the link to the complete film in Chinese. So we'll see some stage later. Thank you.